of a rectangle, so there's stupid mistakes I have, but that I can easily get rid of.
Okay. Let's see if I can find my ACT questions. I think I can do it. Let's see. That's in my online math database, ACT. And let's view that a little differently. Let's view it as details. And, oh, man. The biggest problem I have with my switch is it will not read any of my note files. I cannot believe Windows went to a version that will not read notepad files. And all of my notes that I kept where I had the last question we did,
yeah,
those are still on my backup hard drive. I've got to figure out a way to – I've got about 200 note files that have important information that I need. I'm going to have to somehow – I'm not sure how, but I'm going to have to take those notes and email them to me or something so that I can get – I mean, Windows 10 wouldn't even read the files. It didn't even import them. It acts like they're not there. But – if I remember correct, I believe we started on test 2.
Yeah.
Because we weren't sure if we'd done it or not. And we didn't get very far. Let's have a look at this problem here. Let's see. Hold on a second. Let me scrunch this up. And it took me forever to find these imaginary zoom buttons. When I say imaginary, is they're invisible when you first do it. You have to hit the edit and then find these invisible zoom buttons to figure out how to zoom. Yeah, we didn't do this one. I think we did 3.
Yeah.
So 4 is a really good one to do. Hold on a second. Let me see if I can figure out how to get... let's see. I don't need my calendar for the moment. What do I need? I need OneNote. That's my drawing program. Now, here, maybe you can answer this question. I have 3 apps running, okay? Well, plus the GoToMeeting, but it's scrunched up. If I want to get OneNote and ACT only, I can left snap.
Yeah.
But then that's so small. In other words, I miss being able to size this. Is there any way I can get just these two without losing this one here? If I minimize this, maybe? I see you can't even do
that. There's no minimize on Windows 10.
I know, it's terrible. No, I just did it. I'm not sure how I did it. I clicked on it.
You just click on it.
Okay, all right, good. And, yeah. Okay, I don't know if you can read that or not, but this is a very common problem on the ACT, as you no doubt have discovered, if you took one. And that's where they're asking for, it's what I call an average problem. What is the one key word that you need to remember whenever you're doing average problems?
It's adding them all together.
Totals. In other words, always know that the most important thing isn't the average, it's the total to solve all of these problems. So if we total those up, what do we get? We get 390, 570, 715.
Yeah.
Now the rest of the problem says, what score must be received on the fifth game in order to get an average of 180? So what's my next step?
It Could it just be find the average of that, or
think totals. Think totals. If I'm to average 180 for five games, what must my totals be?
It would have to be 5 times 180.
900, exactly. In other words, that I'm not going to work with these averages. I'm not going to find an average for those four and try to compare it to the 180. That's always the wrong way to go. The correct way to go is to always think totals. So this was 5 times 180. So I now have, that's the total number of pens I'm going to need after five games. This is the total number I have after four games. What do I have to score on the last game?
185.
Piece of cake. If you think totals, just always remember. And these problems can all be worded in very different ways. But I've never seen one yet that didn't depend on totals. It was always about totals. Okay. Number five is kind of an interesting question. You can see my struggles here. It's not as convenient as it used to be. I used to be able to size this window anywhere, keep that the same size, and move this anywhere. So I've lost a lot of ability. Can you read five?
Yeah.
This is how much chrome you have.
Yeah.
And you want to make steel that has 10.5% chrome in it, and the rest is steel.
Yeah.
So approximately, just as a guess, how much should it be?
About like 2,500.
If you look at those answers, that's the only choice, right?
Yeah.
It certainly is not going to be a factor of 100 greater. It's got to be about 10 times this amount. Now, they threw in this 5% to make the math particularly difficult. In other words, if I tried to lay it out algebraically, I would say there's the 10.5% of the total steel has to equal 262.5, so the total amount of steel is going to be that divided by 105, and you could do it that way, but that, first of all, requires you to figure out how to lay it out algebraically, and second of all, is much slower than doing it the first way we did. And it's amazing how many questions on the ACT give you answers like this. Answers that there is nothing close to the correct answer. And you know it's certainly not 262. It's none of A, B, or C. And it's not E. So this answer to that right there, that 262 divided by 0.105 has to be 2,500, and there's no point in even proving it. Just select 2,500 and go on to the next. Now,
yeah.
This is particularly strong in that regards, and they did this for a reason. They want to give the people that use that analysis an edge. In other words, they don't want to force people. A really bright person is not going to set it up algebraically and solve it. They're going to look at it and know the answer is 2,500 instantly.
Yeah.
So that's why they said 10.5% and not 10%. Just to make it a little trickier. Number six.
Would it be 21?
Yeah, it's the perimeter of his kitchen.
Yes, 21.
Two widths plus two heights. Okay, now the tricky part. Getting to the, it's not so tricky. Let me close out that one. And open up this one. And now do this. Oh, what happened to my picture?
I'm not even sure if it's up all the way up yet. You might have to double click it.
Ah, there it is. And now I want to, I'll right snap that one. And
how do you just click the one out? Just click it.
Yeah, very good. Very good. Do you use OneNote a lot?
No. I just understand computers.
Oh, good. You're my go-to guy then when I have problems, huh?
Yeah.
Especially with Windows 10, the fact that you have it. Good. How do I get rid of these menus? Do you know?
That's something I do not know.
Not sure. I think I'll bet it's, no, wasn't that. What does this say? Actual size. No. Didn't really want that, did I?
Is that just the actual size of the picture?
What?
I'm not sure how to change that.
Yeah.
It's one thing I'm not sure about.
And then the moment I move it, it totally loses my scaling. Okay. Well, we can certainly live with that. Number seven, what's the equivalent?
Is it it's A.
Good. In other words, the important thing to do on this one is do your inside parentheses first. Always work from the inside out. When you remove those parentheses, that Z turns into a minus Z. Okay, how about, you know how to do 8. I don't even want to insult your intelligence. 9 is a little different.
These are the ones that just take a little bit of time to do. Not really.
Not really. Exactly. If you kind of think about what's the best way to solve this? Do you have to do any math? My question means always think back solving. Whenever I ask, what's the best way to solve this, you know the answer is going to be either back-solving or picking numbers. Because back-solving will instantly tell you whether it's correct or not. Is A correct?
No.
Is B correct?
Yeah.
Instantly you get it. As opposed to going through all kinds of arithmetic series formulations to come up with the two missing numbers. In other words, this is an arithmetic series with a common difference of 9, but we could waste a whole lot of time trying to do all of that. Backsolving and get you the answer just almost instantly.
Yeah, I just looked at the answers, and they all went 3, 4, 5, and they went six, and then it had to be 5 and 4. So.
Right. Right. Okay. How about number 10? So here, I'll write the equation. If 5m squared, sometimes it's better to start at the bottom than the top, and this is that time. What is m cubed plus the square root of 12m going to be? What's the first step?
Solving 5m squared equals 45.
What's m equal to?
So it's just m is equal to 3.
It's actually plus or minus 3, but...
Plus or minus 3.
That's okay. All we have is positive answers in our answer list, so plus 3 is not wrong. So now, what do I do next?
And then you plug that into the equations.
Okay, so it's 3 cubed plus the square root of 12 times 3. What's that answer? What's 3 cubed?
27.
What's the square root of 36?
That's 6.
Okay. Have you had a chance yet to use the calculator that you're going to be allowed to use on the test?
Yeah, because it's just the Inspire.
It's Inspire, and how do they turn off all of the stuff they don't want you to have?
It's just, we just put it in press the test, which you turn it off and hold control and on, and that goes into a test mode.
Okay, and then you know how to get it out of that, I presume.
Yeah, but you have to have another.
A couple years ago, when the Inspire first came out, one of the teachers at Chatfield, and maybe it was you who told me this, but she had everybody put it in test mode, and then she couldn't figure out how to get it off test mode.
Yeah,
the calculator was stuck.
Yeah, you just have to have another calculator that's not in press the test mode to get it out.
Okay.
So it's a lot of work to get it out.
Uh-huh. All right, the next one. Gives you the volume, which is nice. They don't make you memorize that. And then it gives you the radius. So my question is, what's the best way to do this? Actually, you know what test mode will allow you to do. How would you do this in your calculator?
You can just plug that fully into your calculator.
Okay. Even in test mode?
I'm pretty sure.
Okay. Yeah, I was tempted when I first saw this problem to do it as an approximation. And that actually doesn't work really well. By that I meant I crossed that off with that.
Yeah.
And now I have to know whether 4 times this number is either 157 or 195. And I couldn't figure it out. And I still don't know how to do it without the calculator. I mean, it's hard. You don't want to waste the time to do all of that. But sometimes you can get these answers. In other words, if this was one of those questions where they didn't have 157 as an answer, but 3,000, then you'd pick 195 immediately, and you could do it in approximation mode. Because that, I suspect, is going to take you a while to get into your calculator, even if you're allowed to do it.
Yeah. What the heck did I do? I got a very weird answer. I only got 24.
Oh, 195 is the answer.
Yeah, I don't understand.
You might want to look at that. In your Inspire, it shows you what you put in, right?
Yeah.
Unlike the TI-84, which doesn't really do a good job of showing that to you. So you should be able to tell whether you put it in correctly. Did you put it in as 3.6 or 3 3/5?
3 3/5.
So you put it in exactly, and you cubed it?
Yeah. Yeah, figure it out.
By pi?
Yep. I'll figure it out after the session.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Let's go to the next page. Let's see, I guess I have to close out my previous page first, huh? Yeah, I want to close that one out. Double-click that. Double-click that. Go there. And if you ever see me doing anything in correctly, let me know. Or, you know, if you can give me a tip as to how to speed up what I'm doing, by all means, don't be embarrassed to say something.
I'll play around with OneNote and see if I can figure out anything that makes it faster.
Okay. Notice that these two side menus came up the moment I hit edit. And I couldn't not hit, the only way I can get the zoom button to come up is by hitting edit. So
yeah, I'll mess around with the photo thing too.
Yeah, I'm sure that, you know, if I did some research, I could probably figure out how to do it too. How to get rid of those side menus, because I certainly don't need them using it like this. Okay, how about number 12?
Well, first off, it has to be one of the first three, and then
you got three. You got peanuts, cashews, and almonds.
Yeah, it has to be one of the first
three.
What's
the probability that the nut is not a peanut? So, how many things are not peanuts?
14, so it has to be G.
Good. Okay. Now 13, I don't really think you're liable to run into a problem like 13. It's kind of a matrix problem, but not really. Let's see if you can figure it out. You got 20% of adolescents that make purchases, 35% of adults, and 10% of senior citizens. We're crazy stingy. So, how many purchases are going to be made? If you got 75 adolescents in the store and 20% of them make purchases, how many purchases are the adolescents going to make?
Adolescents, like 15.
Well, 0.2 times 75. Okay. How many are the adults going to make?
35.
And the stingy senior citizens are going to do 3.
So it's 53.
53. Now, notice why this is a matrix problem and why it can be solved by a matrix. Not that that has a lot to do with SAT or ACT, but if I write a 1x3 matrix, let me write it properly. And I multiply it by a 3x1 matrix, I can do that. As long as the number of columns is the same as the number of rows, I can do that multiplication. You remember how to multiply matrices?
No.
You pick this column up, you rotate it 90 degrees to the left and you lay it on top of the other one. And then you multiply entries. Notice that if I did that, the 0.20 would be laying on top of this. So I'm going to multiply that by 0.20. The 0.35 would be laying on top of that. And the 0.10 would be laying on top of that. Do the multiplication, add all the terms, and you've actually solved it by multiplying matrices. All right. Well, I can tell I better get good at this fast, huh?
Yeah. Especially because finals and ACT stuff's coming up.
Obviously screwed up there. I didn't. Hold on. Let's see. I want to snap this one to the left. There we go. No. Oh, this isn't the page I wanted anyway. I don't want to do this page because it's two different pages. Skip that question. It was silly. They've got a question 15 that regards this page also. So I've always had difficulty. Doing that on my computer. We can look at 16. Now notice, here's the edit. In order for me to open up a Zoom, I have to hit edit. And it pops open all of these. Maybe I can't do it without doing that. Actual size?
No, you already tried that. That didn't work.
I know. You're right, I did. Although, this is the only problem on this page. I think it's pretty easy for you, so... This is a magic square.
Oh. I hate these problems.
Oh, they're easy. Add any row, column, or diagonal, and you're supposed to get the same thing. So what do you get when you add the top row?
Do you get zero?
Huh? Same thing you get when you add the diagonal or you add that column. You get zero. So I have to put something in there that makes this column be zero. What would it be?
Just M.
No, that would make it 4M.
Oh, wait, no. No, that, no, it's negative 3M.
Correct. Am I clicking the wrong thing there? Ah, I'm clicking the X that's there instead of that X. That's why that thing was not disappearing before. It's not too bad once you get used to it.
Yeah.
What happened to my other half of my... Let's see.
Just exit that photo's up still, so just exit that and then go down to OneNote again. There.
Okay. And so I can blow this up. It's funny, in order to blow it up. See, if you didn't know those were down there, you'd never find them.
Yeah.
I think I read a tutorial on it or something that alerted me that that's how to do it. And it's annoying that I can't make it big easily. All right, there it is. You read it?
Yeah.
When are you taking your... real test?
April 19th.
Was your first one timed? Did you time yourself?
So I'm in extended time
okay.
because of my dyslexia.
Uh-huh.
So I'm just in, and we get 6 hours to take the entire test.
Instead of three or four?
It's four, and
so you get an extra 50%?
Yeah, and we can take as much time, like it's self-paced.
Okay.
So I didn't take as much time as I needed to on the math because I thought I took a ton of time on the English and didn't do very well.
Oh, I see. So by self-pacing, you mean you could take the math in 30 minutes and leave the other 5.5 hours to do everything else?
Yeah.
If you wanted to? Okay.
Yeah.
Instead of getting 60 minutes for the math. But on average, you're actually, if you took an equivalent amount of time on everything, you'd get 90 minutes for the math. Is that right?
Yeah.
So you get about a minute and a half per problem. All right.
Yeah, and
that should be pretty good for you. Because you got good math skills. So speed is usually the limiting factor on this test. Even people that have really good math skills run out of time. So the fact that you got extended time is going to be really good.
The only problem was I was reading too fast, and so I was missing simple words that screwed me.
Okay. And you know, so on the science portion, there's a tip that I don't know if I've ever given you or not. Read the questions first before you read the paragraphs.
Yeah.
Or look at the graph. In other words, if they've given you a graph that's really complicated and requires lots of detailed looking, go look at the questions first and then go back and figure out the graph. That was a tip that somebody that got like a 36 on the science, she told me that solved. When I took it, the science took a long time because it just did. It didn't seem like they were giving you enough time at all on the science.
Yeah.
But most of the people that I've had as students have done very well on the science, even though I don't work on the science with anybody. I think one person I worked on the science with once, and I realized that the science is really more of a reading than it is a math.
Yeah, it's definitely more reading.
Yeah, it's reading and interpreting, and that's hard for me to do. I don't even know how tutors do that, how they help people with reading and understanding. I suppose you look for keywords and stuff like that, but anyway, that's why I don't work with science. It's never really seemed like a good fit.
Yeah.
Okay, number 17. And on 17, I mean, you can read all of this, but you know what you're looking at there, right? That's a unit circle grid, if ever there was one. 1, 2, 3, 4. So if the product XY, in other words, I would start right here.
Yeah.
Even on this problem, I would start down here.
Yeah.
So if XY is a positive number, where is that point? Which quadrants? Or quadrants?
Wouldn't it be E? Because isn't it a multi?
Yep.
Would that?
Yep.
Do you multiply those?
Like, it's just like tangent. The tangent function is positive in the first and the third quadrant. And the reason it's positive in the third is because both X and Y are negative. In other words, on your reference triangle that you end up with, the Y coordinate is negative and the X coordinate is negative. So a negative over a negative becomes positive, and that's why tangent's positive in the third. In fact, they could have asked this as a trig question. It would have been a pretty good trig question. There's always one of these questions. I'll bet you had a question like this on the test.
Yeah.
And the answer is always the same. What's the answer?
Isn't it just...
Go ahead. Yeah, you don't need to give me the number. Just tell me how to do it.
Isn't it just a...
Yes,
multiplication?
It is. Multiply all three numbers together.
Yeah.
Okay. So... you can always make it, and the question comes in variation. Sometimes it's sandwiches, soups, and drinks. Sometimes it's hat, shirt, and pants. Sometimes it's trombone, drums, and guitar. How many different combinations can you make? And the answer is always you multiply all three numbers. Now, I did see one question once that was the toughest one I've seen because it had 7, 3, 4, and then it said, and the choice of two desserts. And it didn't write the number two, it spelled it. So it was really easy. In other words, if you're used to doing these questions, you look at it and you instantly go 7 times 3 times 4. But if there's a fourth choice there and they don't put the number two in front of it, but indicate that, you know, you can either have pie or cake. In other words, if they ask this question and they added on to it plus pie or cake, you would have to multiply these three numbers by two also. So just be careful not to immediately multiply the numbers when you see the question, even though that's almost always the way to do it. Okay, how about 19? Formulate it mathematically. Give me the ratios that should be involved.
So it'd be 5 to 3.
Now let's use units just so that we're clear, because a lot of times the units reveal the answer. What goes in the numerator?
X.
X females.
Yeah.
And the reason
over
I 6,000. Do it, yeah, you want to make sure you get your units correct. In other words, it might be easy to end up with 6,000 over X, but as long as you use the units next to them, you can't make that mistake. And,
yeah.
And now the problem is really easy. Multiply both sides by 6,000. Notice we don't cross-multiply here.
Yeah.
Cross-multiplying just adds an additional step. Because if you cross-multiply, you then have to divide everything by 3, undoing your first multiplication. So if you just do it by multiplying everything by 6, now you don't need the units. You know you have it set up right. Now you don't even need the calculator. 10,000.
Yeah. Because they gave me a breakdown of what I screwed up on, or what my worst one was.
Do you have the questions that you missed?
Yeah, they were mostly the plane geometry and slash trigonometry.
Next time we meet, if you're not working on anything from class, take a picture of what you missed, and let's go over those kind of questions. That's the best kind of tutoring we can do. Because at this point, I don't know where you're weak and where you're strong, really. But if we knew, we could focus on just those.
Yeah. 1 through 34, I only missed one because I did a stupid mistake. And then the rest of them, after 34, they got
more. Well, that's good to know. But most practice tests are kind of like that. Huh? I'm not positive the real thing is necessarily going to be linearly difficult. In other words, I don't know that you can count on that being the case with the real test. Perhaps. But, in other words, you'd hate to see a question 60 that was a level 1 question, an easy one, and not ever get to 60. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You always want to make sure you get a chance to read every problem. Even if you have to go through it the first time at a much higher pace than you want it to go through it, make sure you see all the problems.
Yeah, that's what I like about having extended time. which can be kind of cheating, but
well,
oh well.
You know, I had another student that had extended time, and he got a 32, which was 99 percentile. And
yeah.
To be honest with you, this kid was one of the had some of the best math skills I've ever worked with. And I did kind of feel like it was almost unfair that he got extended time.
Yeah.
But what the heck? The rules are the rules. You play by the rules, you take advantage of them. You do as well as you can, because I'm not sure that when you apply to college, I don't know if they know your status or not, but if they know that you got extended time, they may take that into account in analyzing whether, you know, to let you into that college or not. So it might be an illusion to think that it's a big advantage. It might be one, but I'm not positive it's a big one. But what's that diagonal going to be?
That's going to be a it's a triangle. It's,
look at your answers. In other words, never overlook the easiest way to solve something. I know you can solve for that hypotenuse using the Pythagorean theorem.
Yeah.
That's a lot of calculation, right?
Yeah, that's
the square root of that. I'm going to have to spend some time in my calculator to do that.
Yeah, it's just
eight. Answers. Yes, exactly. It's the only one it can possibly be. The first two numbers are smaller than one of my sides of the triangle. So the hypotenuse always got to be the biggest. And it's certainly not 578. You've never seen that triangle, I guarantee you.
Yeah, no.
So, again, it's a gift question. But you have to recognize it as a gift to take advantage of it. There's an awful lot of students that immediately plow into the algebra when they don't need to. In other words, that's your first instinct when you see this question, is to go ahead and draw the picture and solve for the hypotenuse.
Yeah. So I went through the 3-4-5 triangle to see if it was just that.
I did too. I was doing the same thing you were doing, and I was incorrectly doing it. I realized that it was not any of our common Pythagorean triangles, and then I remembered, oh yeah, I remember this question. There's only one answer, possible answer. I don't need to solve for it.
Yeah.
And they like doing that. They really do. I think they figure that that gives the smarter kid a slight edge. It gives the kid who can find those little shortcuts a little better chance to do well on the test. And that's really kind of what they're looking for. They're looking, and not necessarily looking for your math ability as much as your intelligence.
Yeah.
Okay. How about this one? Which one is not equal to 5n plus 1?
Is it the first one?
Yes. And the reason it's not, and you don't need to check any of the others, is because how many numbers are equal to their reciprocals? 3 is not equal to 1/3. 4 is not equal to 1/4. So
only 1 is equal to
3. Exactly, only 1. So the only time that that would be equal to that is if 5n plus 1 is exactly equal to 1, which would require n to be 0, which is okay. When n is 0, it is equal to that, but only when n is 0. In general, there's no way that's going to be equal to its reciprocal, not for all n.
Yeah.
And you could spend a lot of time doing all the others, discovering that that's equal to 5n plus 1. That is, because we're going to flip this and multiply, we're going to factor that. That is, And so is that after we factor the top as difference of perfect squares. But all of that is wasted work.
All right.
That's almost the key for speed. Even though you're getting extra time, you can still make good use of it.
Yeah.
What do we need to do to find out the answer?
You need to move 3x to the other side.
Okay, so I got 2y equal negative. I'm going to put it in front because I can tell all my answers are in y equal mx plus b format.
Yeah.
So now I'm just going to divide everything by 2, and that's going to be my answer.
Yeah, so
yeah, this is hardly fair because you can't tell the difference between the fraction bar and the negative sign.
Yeah.
Not that they're going to do that to you on the real test, but I think it's G.
No, you're right.
It's J. Yeah, J is the one that's 3/2 and kind of has a negative sign in front of it.
Yeah, it's either H or J.
Yeah, it's not H because there's no negative sign at all there. You can kind of tell the difference between that 3/2 and that negative 3/2.
Yeah, just the length.
Uh-huh. Okay, and the solution to this equation is... How would we normally do this?
Can't you just factor it?
Okay, how good are you at factoring?
It's not amazing.
Well, there's another way to do it, but I think factoring is the best way myself. The other way might be quicker, I'm not sure. Back solve it. In other words, back solving, and you know 0 is not the answer because clearly the x terms disappear and you'd have 75 equals 0. So 0 is not correct, which leaves you 4 possible answers to test. So that's a lot of work. Let's factor it.
It's x and then...
What are the signs?
Both negatives.
Now we need factors of 75 that add to the number 20.
It's 15 and 5.
And now which is the only answer that makes sense? Let's finish solving this. What are the two answers for x?
It would be x is equal to 15 or x is equal to 5.
Now what's the answer?
E.
Right. See how they try to foul you up here by putting A and B as negatives? Because a lot of people will make this mistake. When they say, what is X? They're going to say minus 15 or minus 5. They'll forget to set this whole thing equal to 0 and solve it, which gives you 15 and 5.
Can you try moving your mouse to the picture side? It totally disappeared. Oh, wait. Because when you were trying to, like, go around the picture,
Nobody else tell me that. And under my old operating system, I think you used to be able to see my cursor. And apparently you can't see it now. I'm moving it up and down on the picture. It's probably, I don't know, is it visible when I'm under one note?
Yeah.
You can see that?
I'm
making circles?
I can only see, like, it's very...
Of course, you don't need, very choppy. Need it. And you don't need it to be visible in one note because, oops.
Because, yeah, it's very choppy.
Well, in one note, I'm always I usually do that to highlight something if I want to point something out. But you're right. I have nothing, no way of pointing to my pictures. Ah, actually, I do. Windows 10 Explorer lets you draw on them, doesn't it?
I'm not sure. I've never actually...
Well, they claim to. I use Google Chrome, so I don't want to switch to Windows Explorer, Internet Explorer, or whatever they call it, Windows Edge. But yeah. One of the things they tout about it is that you can draw on it. I just have never done it, just because I don't want to really make that switch over. But it might be useful. If I could draw on this, it could be helpful. Make sure that I can't.
Maybe it's just the speed that you move your mouse, because...
I don't think so. Like, I'll move it really slow. I'm going to move it from lower right to upper left, slowly.
I can see that.
Oh, you can?
I can see that, but when you were, like, going very fast, I couldn't see it.
Oh, okay. So, you tell me what number I am pointing at on this page.
9.
Okay. Well, that's good to know, because that's all I ever really want students to be able to do is to see where I'm pointing.
Yeah.
You don't really need to follow my mouse around, but if I rest it and point it at 16, I would like you to be able to know that.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, I see what I've been doing. I've been doing this because people used to see that before, but now when I move it like that, they can't see it. So I need to learn to rest it on the spot. Okay, cool. Well, this is helpful. You're being very helpful with helping me learn this.
I mean, you went from Windows Vista to...
I know.
You jumped 3 programs.
And you have no idea of how many nightmare problems happened to me along the way. For example, you have to install Windows 10 over top of a clean hard drive. You can't install it over top of Vista. So the only way to do it is to back up all your files and then install Windows 10 and then to copy your files and reinstall all your software. Well, guess what happened to me? At the last step of backing up all my files, my monitor decides to go on the blank. And it doesn't go completely out. It goes on for like 15 seconds and then goes out. So I kept doing hard reboots and, you know, the image would come up on my monitor and it said Intel Pentium chip. And it gave you, you know, how to change the boot disk strategy and everything. And then it would go out on me, making me think that my hard drive was bad or my motherboard. Was bad. And I couldn't get anywhere. I took it to Best Buy. The Geek Squad guy opens my computer and he says, you fried your motherboard, you need a new computer. So I actually went out and bought a new computer and it didn't work. And only then did I realize, oh, I must have a bad monitor. And sure enough, I went out, bought a new monitor. It worked. Didn't need the new computer anymore. Had to return it. It took me a week to get up and running. It was a good thing there was a spring break last week.
Yeah.
All right. Here, enough of my stories. It's nice to be able to share my nightmare scenario with somebody that can relate to it, who understands computers. You know what I mean? Most people would not be able to relate to all those problems I had.
Wait, so you only had like a couple sessions last week?
Yes.
You had like me and a couple other people? Or?
Yes, and I waited until my last session on Thursday to install the Windows 10. Because I had 3 days in a row without a session. And I needed all 3 of them, let me tell you. By the time I got Windows 10 installed and... had to go through the learning curve. It took me 3 days to even be able to have a session. Oh, and then I couldn't get my drawing tablet to work. I went to the manufacturing of my bamboo tablet to download the newest driver, and I downloaded it, and my drawing tablet wouldn't work. Called up tech support. They couldn't help me. I spent another day trying to figure it out and realized I downloaded the wrong drivers. I needed the drivers for the Bamboo, not the other product they had on there. And I downloaded the proper drivers, and then it started working. But I mean to tell you, I was in a panic mode for a full week. Because I do 90% of my tutoring online. So I had to be able to get every single thing working.
Yeah. That's H.
Okay. That's a good place to stop doing one trig function.
Yeah.
And that's typically the level of difficulty of the trig questions.
Yeah.
They should. Four gifts. There's four trig questions on there, and they should be gifts for anybody that's actually taken a trig course, like yourself.
Yeah.
And though you might find those trig questions towards the end, because they might be considered a high degree of difficulty, but not for somebody that's taken trig. They're going to be, they should be easy, the easiest questions.
Yeah.
All right. Mitch, I will talk to you next Wednesday at 4.
Can we try 3:30? Because I have an ACT prep class at Chatfield, like a full-on prep class.
No, by all means. Hold on a second. Let me just check my calendar. I don't know that 3:30 next necessarily is going to work, but let me see what I got available here.
Because Mondays and Wednesdays I have prep class from 5:30 to 8.
Okay. Let's see what Wednesdays look like. That's next Wednesday. Yeah, I got 3:30 available. You want to do 3:30 to 4:30?
Yeah, and then I have time to get ready and do some classwork.
Okay.
And then
I'll talk to you at 3:30 next Wednesday.
All right.
All right, bye-bye.